group of people is protesting a film about a legendary queen whose historical accuracy is yet to be identified and ascertained. And a film, the objection by this group is to a film that they have not even seen, right? At the heart of the Padmavat debate, to my mind, is not so much the issue of free speech, though there is that as well, but the rights of an individual to watch a film. How do we square this right with the right of a group to take offense? As a group, you have every right to take offense. In India, this is an old debate that goes back to the original sin of banning Salman Rushdie's The Satanic Verses on the grounds that its publication would upset a group enough to threaten law and order. And of course, that group also hadn't read the book, but we banned it anyway. And we've come a long way down the slippery slope since. The people on my panel are eminently qualified to talk about this dichotomy, citizens versus groups versus people. Dipankar Gupta is a former academic, now a full-time writer and speaker who has written and edited 20 books. And the latest is in fact called From People to Citizens, if you can see it over there, the title of this session. Gurcharan Das has the sort of Midas touch that turns nearly everything he writes into a bestseller. The author of 3 non-fiction books, as well as a novel, he identifies himself as a classic liberal. We'll ask him about it in a minute. Madhav Khosla got his law degree from the National Law School, Bangalore, went to Yale, completed his PhD from Harvard, and is currently a junior fellow at the Harvard Society of Fellows. He is the author and editor of 4 books. I mean, I'm jealous. I don't know. He's done 4 books already. Currently working on his 5th, which is a book on the political thought behind the founding, behind India's constitutional founding. I'm going to start by requesting Gurcharan to elaborate. Words of wisdom.
You know, yesterday, we had a session on Swachh Bharat, and amongst the panel, there was a consensus of sorts that if a person could raise his circle of concern beyond the front door of his house, in other words, beyond, if you're living in an apartment, to the passageway, if you're living in a house, to the footpath, if you raise your concern beyond your private space, then you are getting near being a citizen, because being a citizen is taking ownership of a public space. And so, if all of us, when we clean our houses in the morning and we do the pocha katka on the floor, but also include the passage outside or the footpath outside, India would go clean pretty quickly. And so I think the central problem, and both Madhav and Dipankar have really wrestled with this, is that the Indian constitution, a wonderful constitution, but the people of India think that it kind of fell from heaven one day, and they haven't quite taken ownership of this constitution. Mr. Nehru tried, he gave many speeches as the first Prime Minister of our country. But Mr. Nehru was a product of Harrow and Cambridge. And his ideas just did not resonate with the people. Unfortunately, Gandhi died just after we got independence, because Gandhi, through the freedom movement, had sold the liberal ideas of our constitution, of liberty, equality, through the language of dharma, the sadharan dharma. And the constitution makers, the
very privileged group of people who was the Constituent Assembly, they were very serious that the project that they were embarked on, and Madhav and I have talked about this in one of our walks in Lodi Garden, that they were convinced that they were embarked on a moral project. In fact, they, when the flag of India was to be designed, we put the wheel of dharma in the flag, the dharma chakra, Ashok chakra in the flag, and P.V. Kane, who is really a great, great, most Indians don't know this, but he's one of our great heroes. He got a Bharat Ratna given by Radhakrishnan, and he called the constitution a dharma shastra, meaning it's a moral document. So if you think of the constitution as a moral mirror, as a nation building, you see, this is what Mahatma Gandhi understood, that actually nation building entails myths making, you know, and including myths like Padmavati. And he emphasized the notion of sadharan dharma to cultivate the ethical self as a part, and the rule of law then flows out of this sense. And this is why, actually, you know, we were lucky. The Andre Malraux, you know, says that India was a nation created by saints. I mean, unlike Pakistan, which had 10 governments in the first 10 years, and then the generals took power, in India, we've never asked the question. You know, I was invited by the Arab Spring to talk about India's democracy, and their first question they asked was, how did you keep the generals out of power? So we didn't have to keep the generals out of power because that first generation had the legitimacy. But the unfinished project of turning people into citizens is that we have not yet sold our constitution. And you know, I grew up in America, and every morning in school, in college, Americans sell their constitution to their people. You know, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States, you know. And so I think, I thought maybe Jayaprakash Narayan might have done it, where Gandhi, you know, wasn't there. But I hope maybe Mr. Modi will do it. But this is the unfinished project to turn us from people to citizens.
Right. Gurcharan, every country believes it is founded on morality. There is no modern nation that will say that it was founded on bad principles. And so I guess our constitution, the dharma shastra that you're talking about, I mean, is what people will say. And it has often struck me, actually, what you said, which is that why is it that we don't love our constitution as much as, let us say, the Americans do? In fact, even gun control, the big raging battle, I mean, they fall back on the constitution, the right to bear arms.
Right.
And it is something that is, it's a document that is older than ours and yet is inviolate.
Right.
We are amending, and even now today, the debate is, should we remove the word secular from our constitution because it was never originally there?
Yeah.
So our constitution, in a sense, remains a work in progress.
Right.
How would you respond to that?
Yeah, and I think this is absolutely right, that we have to make people believe they own the constitution. And it's not going to be easy.
70
because,
years.
Because India has always been a strong society and a weak state, unlike China, which has always been a strong state and a weak society. Mm-hmm. And the fact is, you need both. You need the strong state to get things done, to have an executive and can deliver. And you need a strong society to make that state accountable. So the three pillars
of a liberal democratic state are an executive that is strong enough to get things done, efficient enough to get things done. That action of the state has to be bounded by the rule of law, and that action of the state has to be accountable to the people. Unfortunately, all our obsessions have been about accountability. We have really forgotten that the problem of our country really is state capacity. Accountability, yes, we've come a long way, right to information and many, many things. Yeah. But we have got to remember that, I mean, why should it take 15 years to get justice in our courts? Why should a civil servant who works 2 hours a day and does nothing, and who works 12 hours a day and keeps the country afloat, get promoted on the same day? Why should the police be the handmaiden of the chief minister? You know? So these are the real reforms that our country needs. More than economic reforms, we need reforms of the state, of governance.
Sure, fair enough. I will be opening this up to questions from you. I know you're going to have a lot. But before I go there, I'm going to ask Madhav to give his perspective.
Namita, Gurcharan alluded to this, but I think one way in which you can think about the transition from people to citizens is to ask, what is it that comes in the way of that transition? Why is it that that transition has been hard? And I think the transition has at least for the last 70 years wrestled with three different kinds of tensions. I think the first kind of tension is a tension between relationships structured by law and other kinds of relationships in society. Obvious examples are kinship relations, caste-based relations, so on. And you imagine that a society where people are citizens is actually a society where law mediates the relationship between individuals rather than status, familiarity, social structure. And in part, what the law does as it mediates those relationships is that it promises anonymity, right? So what's important about the law is that it doesn't matter who you are. And that's been one major tension that we've had to wrestle with, that can you actually create a society where the law superimposes other kinds of social relations? And part of the problem there, as Gurcharan mentioned, is of course implementation, right? Because if you don't have, even if you have the law structuring society on the books, if you actually don't have that in practice, then clearly what's happening in practice is that there is another story that's at work. There's another economic equilibrium that's created, right? So for instance, the question to ask isn't only why does justice take you 15 years, but the question to ask is that if it is taking you 15 years and you're not getting justice, how are people actually resolving that? And clearly there's something else going on the side that's actually structuring the outcome in that case. People are negotiating, bargaining, waiting, surviving, struggling, whatever. And that relationship is then no longer mediated by law in any straightforward sense. I think the second big tension, and this speaks to the Padmavati controversy, is the tension between the state and society. And part of what's been difficult for the Indian project has been the idea that a lot of Western constitutional thought was formulated on the idea that you need to protect citizens from the state. And so you need to create an environment where state power is limited and it's mediated and it's controlled. And a lot of the Indian project has in fact been motivated by the impulse that the state is not the enemy, but society is the enemy. And society is actually constantly spiraling out of control. It's basically a threat. And so part of the reason why we are so sympathetic to curbing, say, free speech, or we are so sympathetic to group rights, or we are so sympathetic to people taking offense, is the fear that, look, actually what's more dangerous than the state is society. And so that's going to completely get out of control. And that's been the big tension, right? That do you actually trust society or do you not? And you see this across the board, whether you see it on regulation of non-governmental organizations, whether you see it in criminal defamation, you see it in a range of projects where the constant argument for state power is that, look, even if state power is bad, the alternative is worse, mm-hmm. because society is just going to constantly threaten and get out of control. And the problem with that story is partly that it's a self-fulfilling narrative, right? It's a self-fulfilling prophecy. So you keep saying that you can't survive without the state, and then you can't survive without the state. And I think the third big tension that's mediated the transition, and Dipankar has of course written about this extensively, maybe more than anybody else, is basically about models of representation, right? And so the question has been, can you actually create a form of citizenship where people speak as citizens rather than through religious identity or through caste affiliation or through some kind of identity? And the problem with a model of citizenship structured around those identities is as follows, right? So one problem is that the promise of democratic government is that we choose our own identity. The whole idea of self-government is that you actually decide who you are. And what happens with this kind of arrangement is that you're constantly constituted by the state. So it's the old joke, right, that in India there's freedom of religion, but there's no freedom from religion. But the meaning of that is actually quite deep, because mm-hmm. it's that you actually don't have a secular religious order where you can opt out and actually have a system where you're not governed by, because you can't choose, right? And so you're already identified as something, and then you have to work within that. The other thing is then you spend a huge amount of your capital and your energy actually fighting with different groups to get more power within the state rather than holding the state accountable. So I become more interested in whether my caste or religious group has more access within the state rather than all of us together saying the state should function mm-hmm. better. And so the big debate there in that transition has been, are you actually going to have a model where you're a power sharing arrangement between different groups, or you're one kind of unity where you can hold the state together responsible? And I think a lot of the story, both constitutional and political, from peoples to citizens has been mediating these three different kinds of tensions.
Mm-hmm. Well, great. I think that's very well put. My question really is that it's a bit of a gloomy situation, isn't it? So the strongest group, and because we identify ourselves primarily through the group, caste, gotra, panchayat, parivar, rashtra, and so on. So, and the strongest group is the one, the loudest group is the one that prevails, as you've seen in Padmavati, in the Padmavat controversy, that you have a very large and vocal group that Scott kind of, captures the debate that's there in the television studios, and that is able to stifle my rights to watch a film. So what is the prescription? What's the way out? You've told us what the problem is. Is there a way out?
I mean, I have no idea what's the way out. I mean, my only sort of sense is that in part, the way out is to change public argument on this, right? I mean, if we are here, and in part, if we believe in conversations, then we must believe at some level that ideas matter mm-hmm. and that public argument matters. And I think the only thing that can be said about that is that you need to have some kind of public argument where you actually take this seriously, where you're willing to bite the bullet, and you're willing to do it both on the right and on the left. I think part of the problem is that a lot of us take a number of positions that aren't principled, right? So we'll criticize the right in perfectly just terms, but we won't, so we'll criticize the BJP, as we should, for running a number of things on Hindu nationalism. But we won't criticize the Congress for actually not providing an alternative picture, but for running Hindu and Muslim nationalism together. And in some sense, both of those stories are actually running the same picture, right? We'll be willing to say that, look, caste quotas might have some place for Dalits, but OBCs are a different category altogether. And to lump Dalits and OBCs in the same narrative of discrimination is actually to do great injustice, right? But nobody is willing to actually say that. And I think that in part, those positions are, I mean, they're politically not feasible, they're politically complicated, and unless you have enough of an argument, it's hard to get by.
Absolutely. Do you think we are moving towards being a more, we're a very argumentative society, as Dr. Sen has pointed out. Are we willing to listen? Are we moving, or are we just living in echo chambers where social media is increasingly amplifying and reinforcing what we inherently know to be the truth and nothing but the truth? Dipankar?
Well, if you leave everything to social media and to people in general, then you're asking for trouble. The real thing is that the state has to step in and make the entry price into violent behavior very, very high, so that people just don't casually, you know, begin destroying property or attacking people or looting or whatever. And this brings me to a very uncomfortable anthropological truth, and that is that people are generally not very good. They generally attack others, they generally are full of themselves, and most people believe that their culture and religion is the best in the world, and everybody else has to, you know, take second, third, fourth place. And this is what democracy actually alters. We talk about democracy in terms of the three pillars, and that's been alluded to time and again: liberty, equality, fraternity. You know something, liberty and equality are pretty easy to implement. I can do them by law very easily. And we have experts here who will probably testify to what I'm saying. But the hardest thing on earth is to implement fraternity. Fraternity is very hard because fraternity doesn't come easy. Fraternity grows against every being in your body and soul that you've grown up with. Your society is anti-fraternity from the start. And this is what you have to combat. So whoever told you that democracy is easy is a liar. Democracy is the toughest job on earth, because democracy is such a contrived human arrangement. Never ever before in human history has anybody even tried to do something like this. And democracy is so tough, but you know, people don't realize it. And you have North Korea calls itself a democratic republic, Chad, Yemen, Eritrea, Ethiopia, they all call themselves republic of one kind or the other, and that lowers the standards of democracy. Democracy is a very difficult job. It's difficult because fraternity is a central principle of democracy. You take fraternity away and there's no democracy, which is why you're constantly fighting against the tide, which is why every major democratic leader is a hero. That major democratic leader is a hero because utopia is on the agenda. Ask yourself, if Gandhi were to go around with the paper and pen and inquire whether or not you want untouchability, I can guarantee you the majority would say untouchability is fine. Gandhi went against the tide and said no untouchability. What was that? That was not listening to the people, that was leadership. Why was that leadership? Because Gandhi felt that there was time that the Indian state rose above its petty societal values. If you were to ask Nehru, you know, to go around again with a paper and pen, asking people, Hindus in particular, do you want Hindu men in particular, do you want to remain polygamous? They would say yes and endorse it. But he went against it, and he had to fight for it. So leaders always have to fight against societal trends in order to make a democracy, in order to make fraternity stand. Therefore, one should ask the question, what is it that makes citizenship? It's not just being a nation state. Being a nation state is very, very simple. Being a monarchy is very simple. Being a theocratic state is very simple. But being a democracy is different. In a nation state, it's simple because there is the hated other. The hated other could be a colonial power. The hated other could be a monarch of some kind or a dictator or whatever. But that is very easy because you can hate somebody. And as some very important theoreticians of the nation state have said, that nation states are most enduring when they are based on a grief. In other words, you might say India's grief is Pakistan, US's grief is the Arab world, and so on and so forth. But if you have a grief that joins you together, it is the most enduring thing ever. More than joy, grief unites. In other words, it's better to have a good enemy than a good friend. Because a good enemy is always plotting and planning against you, and you feel so important about that. Now, if you think of what is then that makes citizenship that goes beyond this idea of grief, because citizenship is not about other people, not hating other people. Citizenship is about liking others, is making yourself like the others, is finding uniformity and equality. And it is here that I would like to recall the words of T.H. Marshall. I think his notion of citizenship was about the best I've ever read. And that is this: citizenship confers an equality of status upon which, mind you, upon which structures of inequality may be built. So at base, you must have equality of status for everybody. And for me, that equality of status comes from universal health and universal education. In other words, when we say society and the state, and that we don't want the society to grow too big and the society is not good enough, or et cetera, the state, in my view, should make the society. In other words, we are looking for a big society. We're not looking for a small society. And the big society is one where universal health, education, transportation, energy are provided so that people have that modicum of stability in their lives upon which they can then be adventurous. And I think this is what's the most important aspect of our citizenship. Citizenship is about other people. It's not about myself. So when, as Gurcharan said, that you should clean your front yard and you should clean your home and everything else, but what's the point if I clean my front yard and dump everything in the neighbor's garden? And that's what we tend to do most of the time. Because my front yard is clean, my road is clean, everything else doesn't matter. And who will come in the way to stop that? It will not be my neighbor, all the neighbors. It has to be the state. Do you know, till about the 19th century, Europe, Paris, was about the dirtiest place in the world. It was called a stinkhole, especially Ile de Paris was very, very dirty. How did it change? Cincinnati was a place where people wouldn't go without, you know, without a handkerchief around their nose. How did that change? It changed because the state stepped in and said, no more. This is what we're going to do. And if you were to dirty the place, not behave in a civic manner, we are going to move in and we are going to make sure you do it. So in other words, if you want a good democratic state, you must have good leadership. You cannot have good democratic state just like that. It doesn't grow spontaneously from the soil. It comes from above. I think I'm going against the trend over here. It comes from above. It comes from deliberate leadership. And if you don't have that deliberate leadership, you will not have democracy. Now, what do we have now? People say, even courts say, that we are taking a certain point of view in deference to the sentiments of the people. The sentiments of the people, if you're thinking of sentiments of the people, let us go back to untouchability. Let us go back to polygamy. And that is sentiments of the people. The state, the democratic state, has to go against this tide. In fact, whenever I think of the great strides in democracy through the 19th century till today, at all moments, I find that there were great heroes who took democracy forward. And these moments are really to be cherished. And you know, over the last so many years, nothing much has happened, but still, I would say, the movement that has taken place in recent years for gay rights is a great movement, is a great improvement. For many, many decades, democracy has been silent, and now it, again, something new has happened. You had, for example, the universal suffrage. Who started it? Important people started it. You had banning of child labor. You had pension. You had universal health, universal education. None of this happened because people wanted it. People didn't want it. People didn't have an idea what all of this meant. It is leadership that wanted it. So if you want a democratic state, pray for good leadership. Thank you.
Thank you. So the classic liberal argument is that when we end up with governments, we don't necessarily like its populism. The people don't know. We know better. And how do you square that then? You know, the people have voted Trump. The people have voted Modi. And the liberals may not necessarily like that verdict, but that's what the people have voted.
Some years back, we had the good fortune of going to the Basque country in Spain. My wife and I, we spent some months there. It was the most educational experience ever. Because, you know, until 1980, when Franco ruled Spain, there was no question of democracy. After Franco left, democracy came in. And in Basque country, I met some of the people who changed Basque country from being the poorest state in Europe to being almost number one. It's next to Germany today in the human development indices, and it is number one in terms of alternative energy. Now, I asked the people of Basque country, including the first prime minister and the finance minister, how did you do it? Did you talk to the people? And you know what they told me? They said, if we talked to the people, nothing would have happened. We did what we thought was right, and then we subjected ourselves to the election. And I think that is what makes for a democracy. You don't go around asking people, what do you want? You don't do democracy with Gallup poll. That's not democracy. You do democracy because you take a risk, you take a chance. You say, I think this is right, I'll do it. And then you judge me. If you think I'm wrong, I'm out. And I think that is how citizenship is forwarded. Do you know, Basque country had a huge unemployment rate. And today, look at it. Basque country, at that poorest moment in his life, started universal health and universal education. when it was really at its poorest, not when it was at its richest. Sweden, when it was poorest. In India, we don't have any of that. Instead, we talk about poor education for the poor, health for the poor, and we've got nowhere. And that is why I believe that you should think in terms of looking after citizens as one, and not separating them and making differences where they should not exist.
I know Gurcharan is dying to come in.
Well, you know, I think what you want is sounds good, but it's not going to be easy. And I go back to the idea, really, that the story of India of the last 70 years is a story of success from below, unlike China, which is a story of success from above. In other words, I know I wrote that book, India Grows at Night. I didn't finish the full sentence in the title because I thought it might be a bit insulting. But the full title should be India Grows at Night When the Government Sleeps. So the rise of India has been a rise despite the state. And it goes back to the point I was making earlier that India has always been, Indians have been defined by society and the Chinese have been defined by the state. So therefore, even we had four empires in our history, the Maurya, the Gupta, the Mughal and the British. All these empires were weaker than the weakest Chinese empire. So the fact is that you are dealing with, in India, oppression came from society, not from the state. In China, oppression came from the state. In India, the king had to uphold dharma for the people, but because dharma preceded the king. Whereas in China, the emperor gave the law and then he interpreted the law. So in India, the interpretation of the law was by the Brahmin. So you had very early created a liberal division of powers that weakened the state, even in the Nanda kingdom, which was our first kingdom. So what I'm trying to get at is that, sure, all the things that we want are that India has to grow during the day. We need, therefore the emphasis really should be on state capacity. This is, you know, we've with democracy, we want everything. We want this right, we want this, but we don't think of the fact that. And it's not just because we should have more judges in order to get justice in the courts.
Well, we should have more judges and we should have more courts as well.
But it's also how, it's the how that we need to modernize.
Absolutely.
So for me, actually, the biggest reform is not economic reform. It is precisely to get to a point what you're talking about. And for that, actually, we need state capacity,
and then I'm going to ask Madhav to jump in as this kind of young voice of India,
I mean, just a couple of thoughts. One is, I think both Dipankar and Gurcharan speak to something that's true, but I think the risk is I think it's somewhat a false dichotomy to set up this, whether India needs the state or doesn't need the state, right? I mean, the bottom line is that it needs both. And part of the Indian tragedy isn't that you have too much state and too little state, it's that you have the state doing things it shouldn't be doing, and you have other people behaving in ways that they shouldn't be behaving.
Such
and so it's the famous line that the problem isn't that, the problem in India isn't that it doesn't have, that it needs the state or it needs the market, is that the state behaves like a market and the market behaves like a state, right? And so I don't think the point so much is, do you need the state and do you not need the state? I think that you need far greater calibration of what you actually want the state to do. And you want the state to enforce the rule of law in certain sectors. You don't want the state deciding what syllabi should be taught for a course on justice in Delhi University. Right? And I think that's the real question. The real question isn't, do we need a state, do we not need a state, right? I mean, we need both, right? You need the state and you need alternate structures. I think the second and this sort of links to Gurcharan's point about state capacity, is a lot of the ways even in which we think about reform, we've already internalized to an almost perverse degree the idea that the system doesn't work. And so we always want to fix the system in a way to knowing that the system actually doesn't work. So I'll give you a concrete example. India is one of the fewest countries, very few countries in the world that has anticipatory bail. It is the most bizarre provision in the world. You can get bail even before you're arrested. Now, why do you need a provision for anticipatory bail? You need anticipatory bail because you don't trust the police that they'll actually arrest the right person. Now, the standard solution to that is that you work on police reform. But we don't want to work on police reform. We don't want to fix the idea that they could actually arrest the wrong person. So instead, we fix the idea that, oh, if they arrest the wrong person, let's find a remedy to that, right? And your entire system is structured around a kind of symptomatic reform or symptomatic justice. And the argument for criminal defamation is the same. I mean, the state's defense in criminal defamation is that you can't have civil defamation in India, only civil defamation, because civil defamation requires a functioning court system. In India, it will take 20 years, so you need criminal defamation. Then you fix the court system, right? It doesn't mean you make everything a crime. And I think that I think we need to think very seriously, not only about how you reform, but what you're actually hoping to fix.
Yeah, absolutely.
Several things. Very quickly, when we criticize the Indian state, it's not because the Indian state is big. We criticize the Indian state because it's inefficient. If you look at bigness, America has 5 times more per capita officials, state officials, than India has. So America and Europe, they have many more officials, government officials, per capita than India has. The whole idea of a bloated Indian bureaucracy is not in terms of numbers, but it's bloated because it's inefficient. And because it's inefficient, it really hurts when you see these people, you know, living rather well and not doing anything at all for the population they're supposed to serve. It is not, therefore, numbers that counts, it is the quality that counts. Mm-hmm. And the quality is very poor, and that's why we are so upset about the Indian bureaucracy. That's the first point. The second point is, I'm afraid Gurcharan and I have a completely different view of traditional India. In fact, my view is more Nehruvian, and you might say it is perhaps left liberal or whatever. The view is this: when Nehru looked at in the discovery of India, when he looked at Indian history, he found many things in Indian history that he was proud of. He thought of the great saints, he thought of the great philosophers of India, and then he also thought of the majesty of the Himalayan mountains and the deep seas to the south, all of that stuff. And when he saw the Ramayana going through the country, his blood kind of was sort of charged up. But then he said, there's some terrible things about this country, about our culture, about our history and civilization, that we have to stamp out. We cannot allow those things to happen. And many of those things were creatures of the so-called sacred sects and sacred books. And he wanted those things to be stamped out. When the British came to India, we're talking about the Brahmins were not all that powerful, by the way. When the British came to India, they didn't know what to do with Indian culture and customs because there were so many. There wasn't a Brahmanical culture or custom. People didn't know what on earth this Yajnavalkya Smriti was or the Manu Smriti was. Very few people know. Even now, if you were to walk out and ask people, do you know what the Purusha Shukta myth is about? I can guarantee you 90% will say, we don't know what you're talking about. So when the British came to India, they didn't know what to do because there's so many customs and religions and traditions. So they asked Brahmins mistakenly, what should we do? And the Brahmins happily said, do this and do that and the other. That is how the non-Brahmin or anti-Brahmin movement began in the Bombay Presidency and in the Madras Presidency, because these people in Bombay and Madras Presidency said, who on earth are these Brahmins to tell us what to do? They are nobody. They were our service castes. If you look at the Brahmins today, you will find that most Brahmins who have any power are not Brahmins who perform rituals, but are landed Brahmins. The Anavil Brahmins of Gujarat, from where Boraji Desai came, the Jhas of Bihar, they are the ones who are powerful, and they will never give their daughters in marriage to a ritual specialist. If you're thinking of what India was running on in the past centuries, believe me, it was local custom, local tradition, and more than anything else, it was the power of the village oligarch that was ruling. The power of the village oligarch. The village oligarch decided who was to be number one, number two, and number three. In Bengal, for instance, Ballal Sen, who was 11th, 12th century monarch, he decided on the ranking of Brahmins, a Kshatriya deciding that. So I don't think Brahmins rule. The point really is this, that do we want societal prejudices to rule? And societal prejudices come naturally to people, whether or not you're in America or in India. We're talking about America with the pledging and this and that and the other. There are great, large numbers of people who have such great deep prejudices in that country. Deep prejudices which we see today. Such deep prejudices, so what's the point of swearing by the Constitution? I would say, if you don't think of the Constitution in your everyday life, and the Constitution doesn't come in the way but only facilitates your work and your living, that is the best Constitution. You don't have to remember it. For example, do you have to open Fort Knox every morning to tell people we've got the money? There's the gold. Do you have one military to parade down the streets to tell people that we have power? No. These things should be internalized. They should be there. You should feel secure. In my view, if you want to have a good nation state, you must move beyond that to becoming a democratic state. And to do that, citizenship is important. And for that, you need autonomous individuals. And for that, you need individuals who can make up their own minds. And in case you're wondering how to do that, I would say universal health and universal education are the starting points.
I agree. And we also, if I could add to that, people also, if, you know, if you're saying that people are prejudicial, people also take their cues from leaders. And I think maybe that is what sometimes happens when you have a leader like Trump or when you have a leader like Modi, who does not speak up enough when hate groups prevail. You then legitimize that hate speech. You then make it okay to speak against a caste or against women or against a certain group because the leadership is silent. So there is, in that sense, a moral failing.
What we should realize is that Gandhi was a person with infused with utopia, and he was willing to take people head on. Let's remember that. Gandhi was a great reformer, not simply because he wanted to tinker with Hinduism, but because he wanted to frontally assault it. And that is what made Gandhi fight and be such a democratic leader of the country. He is not an idiosyncratic person with mud packs and stuff like that. He had much more to him. And his contribution to democratic theory is what we must unearth and rescue.
And what we should avoid, the legacy of Gandhi, is the legacy that Anna Hazare took, which is that go by the path of protest rather than the path of citizenship. Instead of strengthening citizenship, what Anna Hazare and Arvind Kejriwal did was they diverted attention from really institutions to protest.
Well, let's not forget Anna Hazare's own beginnings in the prohibition and anti-alcohol, where people in his village who drank were tied to the trees and flogged. So he's not a great Democrat, and I'm not sure he's a great democratic role model at all. Incidentally, I don't know if you know, but the Rajasthan High Court has an interesting statue. I don't know whether they still do, correct me if I'm wrong, of Manu, the lawgiver. He's here in the Rajasthan High Court. And if you're talking about delayed justice, there is one woman whose case has been pending in the Rajasthan High Court for almost 30 years. Her name is Bhavari Devi. She lives here. She lives in the state. And her case, you know, I don't know if you know the back story, the gang rape, a lower court rules. You know, is this, have you read about it? So the lower court rules that no, she could not have been gang raped because the accused were upper caste men, and how would they have touched a Dalit woman? So he says, not guilty, free. So she's in appeal, and that appeal is pending in the Rajasthan High Court with Manu the lawgiver. His statue is out there in the grounds, and that says something about waiting for justice. It talks about, I don't know why women have not emerged as a identity group. You know, we talk about identity politics. I'd love to see women are out voting men in every past election, and we've not emerged as the group that is being placated. I wish we were. If you have any counter rebuttals, otherwise I'll open it to the audience.
Yeah, time is 15.
But you know, Madhav, I think wants to say something.
No, I mean the one thing. I mean, Gurcharan, maybe you can just say a little more about this one point, because you alluded to it at the end, which is about institutions. One of the scary things in the last decade or so is that we've seen the erosion actually of three major public institutions, which earlier were among the three that had major regard, and that's the Election Commission, the RBI, and now the Supreme Court. Yeah. And you've seen institutions decline throughout the 70s onwards, but it's right. Really interesting that these three have held sway.
Yeah.
And in the last decade, we've even seen these three go down, right?
Yeah.
And you see, I mean, even what's happening with the four judges. On the one hand, clearly the Supreme Court is being incredibly managed, like incredibly mismanaged. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, judges are behaving like this is university politics. Yeah. I mean, there's no allegation.
May I just correct you on one point? That is, I think you can say whatever you want, but the RBI has not been degraded for the last decade because I was in the RBI. I know that for a fact. So what you may say of the RBI may be valid for the last year or two years, but certainly not for a decade.
Right. Well, still, if these institutions, you're right. I mean, the Supreme Court, the RBI, the Election Commission. Still, despite the worry that we have for the present, I happen to think this is just a blip. Actually, these three institutions are institutions that we should be proud of, and we need far more institutions like these. Where we need help is frankly in the lower courts.
Right.
That story she told just now, you know, these are the horror really is how the lower courts function. And you know, I mean, you're absolute. I mean, when we talk about state capacity, we're really talking about building institutions.
But I think Madhav's point about the higher judiciary and the crisis in the higher judiciary is well taken, and there's no point denying that there is a crisis. I mean, it may not have been the best possible way to do it, or, you know, like a university election, as you said, but yes, there is a problem. I'm going to open this to, yes, please. Can we do one thing? I'm going to take three questions together. If you could just let me know who it's addressed to, and I want the mics. I don't want to waste time with the mics going back and forth. So can we have a mic here to the gentleman in the brown shirt, one here to the gentleman in the beard, and I'd like a woman. Come on. Here she is, right here, in the pink. Let's go.
It seems to me we've been talking a lot about the problems that the state has and the problems the state, I mean, about the things that the state is trying to do. But I know this is all a matter of record, that the current government did try to reform the judiciary with the NJAC. I don't know the merits of whether it was good or not.
Ask your question quickly because I want to include.
What I'm trying to say is, how much control does the state have in terms of the institutions that, I mean, the three big institutions that you spoke of? How much control does the state have if we were to, you know, people don't like the current government, people might not like another government in place.
Right, yeah.
If we were to get a common denominator, how much would that government, if it had a reformist tendency, it had a, you know, how much would it be able to do?
Got it. So how much can a government reform? Let's take the next question. Yes, sir.
Yeah. My question is to Dipankar. I'd like to understand that in recent times, there's a lot of confusion between leadership being converted into a dictatorship.
Okay.
So how would you differentiate that when it is leadership and when it is dictatorship?
Good question. Ma'am, you had a question?
So it seems to me that a lot of the confusion here is because of the fact that there is a false dichotomy between the state and the society. I just want to address this to everyone. I mean, as anthropologists and people who are jurists, why you would make that division in the first place? Because you make this argument about people having a powerful public narrative and argument. Mm-hmm. But with everyone else, and what you said about Trump or anyone else, the point is, how much are we willing to listen? Because it seems that we are in a paradox. Like, there's more information, but we're not listening anymore.
So
even to Dipankar Gupta, this is my main question. You would say that you're taking the top-down approach, but everything in the history of any country has not been granted because it should have, but because it was fought for. Be it a Sunday and a laboring day or a woman with the right to vote, everything has been fought for. So what leads you to believe that the state would be the opposite of your anthropological truth, which is not essentially evil?
Dipankar, you want to go?
Let's take the suffragettes. They were people who were not actually from the mass of women. They were people who actually fought and came to the top, and they could have, you know, led a life of leisure. All the leaders of the suffragette movement were not people. There was no groundswell for women wanting the right to vote. Like, there was no groundswell either. This may sound very strange to you and me, but the fact of the matter is, there was no groundswell either for universal suffrage or for women of men, you know, fighting for voting rights without property attachments. all of this happened because there were certain leaders who said this is not right. And some of those leaders, by the way, were crusty conservatives. In Disraeli's cabinet, they were very, very conservative people. And those are the ones who said that there should be a proper law about union of workers' rights, about housing rights. Lloyd George talked about insurance. So these were not people from the masses. They came up and they said, these are the things that we need for everybody to enjoy. So the point I'm trying to make is this, that a leader, I think this addresses your point, that a leader can easily become a dictator if the leader doesn't submit herself or himself to the will of the people every election time. That, I think, is a basic trick. If the leader wants to ride and, you know, not really bother to go against the tide, then you'll play to the societal weaknesses and prejudices. And that's so simple. And that's why I said it's easy to be a nationalist than to be a citizen. Mm-hmm. You might remember the old debate between Gandhi and Rabindranath Tagore was primarily on this basis. And I think to be a citizen is very, very difficult. But, you know, a good leader is one who takes up the challenge. And whenever we've had movements in democracy, as I mentioned to you earlier, we've been very lucky that we had good leaders at those times who took it forward. And whenever democracy goes to sleep, whether at day or at night, is because we don't have good leaders.
Just to answer the question that the gentleman here asked, that the problem of the Supreme Court issue, I think, you know, if you think about it, the whole idea is grounded in the notion of separation of powers, the balance of powers. And the judiciary has been wanting to guard that power. But I think, you know, in the United States, so because the government proposed that the appointment of justices should be one that involves all parts of the government, of the state, the judiciary has let us down in that respect. I mean, in the United States, there is a role played by the executive. There's a role played by the Senate, who ratify a judge. So even in India, you need that. And I think that's one of the problems where the law, which was a good law, that the Supreme Court did not agree to it.
Yeah, I mean, just on that question about how much can you actually reform, I think it's a fair question. But I think the important thing to remember is that the worst thing for politics is cynicism, right? And part of democratic politics is built on the idea that you can exercise your vote because you can change things, right? That it's built on the idea that we can actually transform how we are governed. And I think the tragedy of a lot of politics is that you already assume that things are going to be the way they are. And then you say, how do I best manage it, right? Police aren't going to function well. What do I do if they arrest the wrong person? Mm-hmm. Caste groups aren't going to be fighting. How do I manage the violence? And the cynicism sort of feeds on itself, right? So I think the antithesis of democratic politics isn't so much monarchy or autocracy. It's actually cynicism, mm-hmm. right? And fake news, for instance, is cynicism of the most profound kind, because it's cynicism of the kind that, look, Namita is not going to actually, I can't change anything. I can't get this tap to work. So all I have to do is, if I can just show Namita a picture that the tap is working and I show it enough times, she'll start believing me, right? So there's, I mean, and this is hyper-reality, that there's actually no difference between the tap working and the tap not working, so long as I just believe that the tap is working, right?
It's what you believe.
And I think that kind of cynicism is basically sort of nihilistic, and that's the worst. That's the worst kind of approach to politics.
Absolutely. I'm going to take another round. At the back, the lady in the glasses. There's a gentleman here with the beard. I want you to be fair. Ask very short questions, because then we can just get. I want one person from this side at the back. Take your pick, volunteers. Okay. Yeah, let's go.
Hello. My question is directed to Mr. Gupta. And I would like to ask that a good leader's major component is having integrity. And like you mentioned, going against the tide and against the time of the society and bringing some change. But now, given the fact that every human being works on the basis of self-interest, And that self-interest might be that he wants to win the next election rather than being concerned about what the society needs. Mm-hmm. So in that context, how do you expect good leaders to actually come forward?
Good. Self-interest. What was the next question? If you have a mic, go ahead and ask it.
My question is might be a little bit tangential to the to the panel, but I'll go ahead. See, I have been in this festival for, since yesterday, and almost all the sessions that I've attended had to do something, had to say something about this Padmavat issue. Now, while it's important to discuss this issue,
it's called news.
It is important to discuss this issue, but I feel that in last 2-3 years, we have been seeing so many of this banning and so on and so forth. At a time when more than half the country is going through tremendous farmer distress, labor laws are being frowned left and right, employment sort of eludes us continually. And last week, Oxfam report says that 73% of the wealth created has been usurped by one. The question is, therefore, as a part of this middle-class educated citizenry, whose voices probably matter more than most of our country's countrymen, are we the ones who are failing the republic by just prioritizing the issues of discourse?
I will answer that question before I come back to the third one. As the only journalist on this panel, I apologize. I really apologize. I think media's fall in focusing and media's fault in focusing on clickbait, on these ridiculous TV debates, for the sake of your sanity, for the sake of everybody's sanity, please stop watching TV news. It is hideous. And it will do exactly what Madhav is saying. It is going to feed on cynicism. It is feeding on a prearranged narrative. Please, I apologize on behalf of my community, my journalist community. You are right, there are 100 more important stories to be told. I was sitting at Sainath's session and ashamed of how much I have to learn.
I mean, the only other thing to say is that just because that's the only thing being discussed at JLF, doesn't mean that it's the only thing being discussed
reality
everywhere.
Is
the only people who think JLF matters so much are the speakers.
And
but there are plenty of other people who are genuinely like, so this is,
I agree.
That's also the
we're
other
taking
thing.
Taking a third question, then we're going to go back to that one. Who had the mic here? Yeah. Just check that your mic is working, no? When, as soon as you get it,
Hi, so my question is primarily to Mr. Dipankar. So you spoke about, again, about leaders, good leaders needing to oppose the will of the people or, again, speak against the tide. However, I mean, you spoke of Gandhi and Nehru doing it, but they had a certain legitimacy because of the freedom struggle. In today's date, what gives leaders that legitimacy to become good leaders wherein they can oppose the will of the people, subject themselves to elections, and then hope that, as you spoke of, you know, that dichotomy of people essentially being selfish. So how do they then derive that legitimacy when people are selfish?
Dipankar.
Yeah, thank you very much for your questions. Self-interest and leadership, it often seems as if these two are contradictory, which they are at first sight. But there are examples where there were leaders who went against the self-interest and did rather well. Robert Peel, for example, went against the Corn Law in Britain, when he was one of the largest landowners of Britain and benefited hugely from the Corn Law. His relations, friends, cousins, uncles, they all, you know, were up in arms against him. What are you doing? But he fought for it. He lost the election. He came back and he fought again and he won. So a leader is a person who can actually take on risks, risk even in terms of their own self-interest. And that, I think, is a very important point. If you don't take risk, if you cannot go against your own self-interest, you cannot be a real leader. The second thing is really this, that when we think about fake news, I don't know if it's in my life, and I'm pretty ancient, I'm 68 years old, I don't know of a single period in my conscious life when the news has not been fake. It has been fake for a very long time, and please don't fool yourself into believing it's fake because the TV has come in. Maybe they've added to it. But there have been fake news all the while, which is why I don't want to speak on any subject where I don't have first-hand experience, because I have always been misled by newspaper reports.
He's not on WhatsApp, obviously.
And the other thing is the middle class. I think the middle class is really letting the side down.
Yeah.
People like us count for more than our numbers do. And that is what we must realize. But where have you heard in drawing room conversations and cocktail circuits, where have you heard this being said, that we should have universal health and universal education? Nowhere. Where have you seen a politician stand outside a hospital, look at all the lines behind him and say, I'm going to take care of this? Nowhere. Politicians will stand in front of everything else, but never in front of a hospital. Have you seen one? I have not. Therefore, if you think of the middle class, I think we have a huge responsibility. I mean, we can be cynical about JLF, et cetera, et cetera. But this is here where ideas meld. And I think that is very important. Wherever you have the chance to make your ideas known, make it known.
Thank you very, very much. I know you have a lot more questions. I'm going to prevail on my dear authors to sign books, which are also available over there, and you can ask them further questions.